Morning.
Morning.
What you got then?
Well, there's egg and bacon, egg, sausage and bacon, egg and spam, egg, bacon and spam, egg, bacon, sausage and spam, spam, bacon, sausage and spam, spam, egg, spam, spam, bacon and spam, 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 egg and spam, 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 bacon, spam, spam, spam and spam. Oh, lobster thermidor, crevettes with a mornay sauce, garnish with truffle pate brandy and a pie gate on top and spam. Have you got anything without spam in it? Well, spam, egg, sausage and spam. There's not much spam in it. I don't want any spam.
Why can't you have egg, bacon, spam and sausage?
That's got spam in it.
Not as much as spam, egg, sausage and spam.
Look, could I have egg, bacon, spam and sausage without the spam?
Yeah.
What do you mean? I don't like spam.
Spam, 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 spam.
Spam. I love it. I'm having spam, 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 spam.
Baked beans off.
We can have spam instead.
You mean spam, 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 spam,
now you can do the normal bit and do your introduction and what have you.
All right. Well, hi guys, I'm Bob.
And I'm Ben. Welcome to Bluffers to Buffers. Special episode here, Bobby, because it's Spamfest at the time of recording. Spamfest. Little event we've put together with Hornby themselves.
Awesome.
Neville Grove and Flying Scotsdan from Instagram.
Cool.
Just it kind of developed. It was just one of these themed weekends that kind of got carried away, as it were.
You've certainly got carried away. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. And it's resulted in this. So obviously I've got a few, and this video is about my few spam cans.
When you say a few?
20. I don't really know how to play out in regards to chatting about it, because I've done a bit on each of the locos, but
not
busting lot, because 20, even 20 times 1 minute is 20 minutes, but this video is half hour, spoiler alert. So I figured I've got some production notes here, so I'll just, you know, work
through. I'm going to put it out there straight away, though. I don't actually like spam.
What, the meat?
The meat.
No, well, I've never tried it. What we should have done is bought some.
Absolutely not.
Obviously, before we go anywhere, you need to like and subscribe our channel, purely because, you know, there's nothing quite like it.
No, there certainly isn't.
Also, it's worth noting that we, Hornby are giving away a locomotive that's been weathered by Mr. Neville Grove.
Awesome. That it's one is
of their,
worth it.
Yeah, it's one of their latest release of spam cans. Competition entry details are documented on Instagram, what have you. Basically, you got to subscribe to both of our channels, that's ours and Neville Grove, and put a post on this here video. Was it up? Is it up or it's down?
Down.
Put a post down there. And Hornby will do the rest. Someone could win that loco. So, anyway, what you've seen there is the bulk of my fleet, or all of them.
Are these all different ones?
They're all different ones. That is my effort at a cavalcade. I couldn't do them all at the same time, but I've not been so stressed as I have been trying to get this video done for this weekend. When we had the idea on Instagram, it's over one of these weekends, because you have a lot of them. Yeah, it'd be brilliant. And then it's kind of escalated, and but it's good. It's my favourite kind of loco, so fitting.
Yeah, I'm with you on
that. We're into it. This is the first, in no particular order. This is a very recent release by Hornby. This is local locomotive's name is East Asiatic Company. Been looking forward to this one for a couple of years, as you know, and it came
good
out.
Good shade of blue as
it's
well.
It's lovely, yeah. that is it in its standard form. Lovely looking though, I think you'll agree. The only thing for me that lets it down is the quality of the badge. You can't really see it, but it's neither here nor there. It looks great. So I'm going to try and educate you towards spam cans.
Yeah.
And hopefully our viewers, and also probably mislead a lot of people with my false information.
Brilliant.
And butt in and out of what we see on the screen. So if you see something on there, just stop me and I'll
look forward to bringing the element of surprise.
So, first and foremost, bullied. We've spoken about him before.
We have.
Did you know, Bobby, that actually he used to work with Mr. Nigel Gresley? So he was...
pinch a few ideas.
He worked on the Pacific A4, so he obviously he took a lot of inspiration from the Air Smooth and Streamlining and what have you. He obviously saw the big engines and got the yawn about it and wanted to bring it down to the southern region when he got the job down south. They needed a Pacific locomotive to run our routes around here, or a bigger locomotive to run the passenger and the express trains. Originally, he was going to go for an 8-coupled design, so that's 8 powered wheels rather than the 6 you see in the middle there. But they settled for a 462, your Pacific, whatever your Pacifics are, because the 8 in the middle was parred. I said, no, you ain't having none of that, basically. And this was in wartime, you need to remember. And the
austerity measures.
Well, the government were like, no, don't really need to be making passenger express locomotives. What we need is heavy freight stuff, you know, to move tanks and supplies and what have you about. And there was a shortage of materials. So they basically said, no, haulage stuff only. So what he did, cunningly, he passed it off as a mixed traffic, so it could do freight and passenger, although in the end it was classed as a passenger locomotive. But he actually got a telling off for using too many materials and what have you at a time in the middle of the war. But it's pretty cool that he managed to sneak it through, don't you think? So this is Royal Mail. This is the early, you know, one of the, which is number 3 off of the production line, so it's a very different shape, you'll notice, to the other one. That as a loco is A, quite rare, and B, absolutely, this is only the second time it's been out of the box. The first time was for the last Merchant Navy video we did.
So this hasn't got the little streamy liney bits at the front. And
this has, it hasn't got the smoke deflectors that you see. They had to change this design because it basically sent smoke straight back at the driver.
Right.
Couldn't see what he was doing.
Good effort, though.
Yeah, I think that's... Well, this is number 3, so it's slightly different to the first
two. Good third effort,
yeah.
Though.
I really like the shape of that as a logo. I think it's...
it's proper.
Yeah, really nice.
Are you going to mention the wheels?
I haven't actually put a note of that in my production note.
That's the only thing I know about them. They got the bullied wheels, as it were.
Now, when he was designing it, old Bully kept it under his hat. It was mainly done at Brighton, but he had a bit of work done at Eastleigh and some at Ashford. So only a very few people knew about it. He was quite secretive about it. Just digressing slightly, this is one that Mr. Neville Grove has done. He'd also renamed and numbered the blue one, but we've missed that now. But this has been done dirty. You know, I'm a fan of his oily rag weathering. This one's mucky, as they say. This was the first sound-equipped loco that I bought, or steam loco
you purchased?
Yeah.
Nice.
Doesn't work anymore, but...
What do you mean it doesn't work?
There's something about the Hornby TTS decoders and my Gauge Master Prodigy, they just don't get on very well at all.
Best friends at all.
It struggles to talk to it. But, I mean... with quite a bold and imposing design. You remember it, if you think about it, this was 1941 when this, you know, that the Royal Mail one, the one we just saw, came out. It was very different to, I mean, it even looks different to, if you think Mallard or all the A4s were in 1935, so 6 years previously.
Mallard is definitely more Art Deco looking, than this is more industrial streamlining.
This certainly these later ones, yeah. Like this is the first one, this is Genesis.
Yeah.
21C1 channel packet, my favourite loco on the whole fleet.
Yeah.
We've been through it before. Neville Grove again, giving it the oily rag look. Got a great story behind it, which I'm sure I've documented before. But this one hit the rails as a prototype in February 1941, Bob. Did you know that?
Wow, I didn't. I do now.
After extensive trials and a lot of modifications, it hit the main line in June, I think, of that year. It's the second one along the line, which was Union Castle, which we'll see in a bit. Also was finished in about that time. But, and here's the thing, both were 7 tonnes overweight. So Bully had to get in there and have it a little change. And one of the things they did, believe it or not, see that Southern plaque and 21C1, they were big metal things when they did it, but from the number three onwards, like Royal Mail, they had to lose that to help lose some of the weight, pissing in the ocean, really. But it was painted on after that.
Really?
But they had to use thinner steel in different places. They put bigger holes in the frame. Race cars have got holes everywhere. Well, these had bigger lightning holes in here. They put thinner steel in places to get that weight down to where it needed to be.
Was that for track limits, as it were?
Yeah. So it was only, even to that, brought down, it still couldn't run on all the lines in the south, which is why they had to bring out the Battle of Britain in the west countries, which is a lighter weight, light Pacific, as they
Runs a clan line already.
Yeah, well, it's not in any. What I should have done was do it in order on the screen, really, date order, but I didn't. Sue me. So
I didn't know clan line was in the date order anywhere.
The numbers at the end, so 28, this was the 28th Merchant Navy to
have been built.
Yeah, there's one. But they changed the type of numbers when BR took over. It's all very complicated and quite boring.
I'm sure you'll tell us all about it.
Well, later. I might not. So after the first two, once they'd sorted out the problems, the rest of the first 10 were delivered between September 1941, Bob, and July 1942. Just diversion. Clan 9 has obviously been rebuilt and is in preservation today. It's the one that passes by the workshop.
Indeed,
it looks more
it.
Like a normal, what you'd say, a normal steam engine, steam thing. Not allowed to say steam train, but people call them steam trains. It's not a train unless it's got the carriages on, are they? Steam locomotive, that's the word I'm looking for.
It hasn't got all the bits on it, has it, basically?
No. So, after that first batch came out, the second batch was spawned. They look more like this, whereas the first 10 looked like the real air smooth one, the first ones we saw. They started to look like this. The cab was different on the middle 10, and there were differences, which I'm sure many
enthusiasts. That's the correct terminology there.
This is be able to identify. So 29, second to last, the penultimate locator to roll off the
signs are painted on.
Yep. Well, this is well down the line now.
Picking up on what you told me.
Because they were done in batches of 10, so the first 10, and then you had the second 10. And then in 1948, the railways were nationalised. Everyone, the big four, as it were, Southern, LNER, LMS, and Great Western, they were all linked into one British Rail. And that's when all the numbers changed to, rather than 21C or whatever, changed to that. Anyway, you're lost, I can tell. They were going to order another 10, they had 20, they were going to order another 10, but there was a shortage of materials, so it knocked production back a few years. But by this time, they'd cut down on the amount of rivets they were using, they were welding more bits, which means the weight was coming down, so he was getting in his stride. You may or may not know that these have got the valve gears driven by chains, rather than, you see on the side of a loco, you've got loads of extra rods that control the pistons in the front, sort of thing. These are chains that run in oil baths. Very unique design for Bullied. That is what caused them to wheel slip quite a lot as well.
What, oil getting onto the
track? Because their oil was being splashed out and onto the wheels, and then so they were renowned for wheel slipping as they pulled away, but on the flip side, once they're up and running, they were one of the smoothest.
Right, okay.
Apparently, which is nice. here's the thing, the boiler pressure in these was originally 280 psi.
Wow.
Imagine being stood in that cab with 280 PSI in front of you. I know they got valves and that lift if it's ever going to, you know,
get Did any of them ever explode on these particular models?
Not these, no, but it was reduced to 250 after a time, but still a lot of pressure. For every square inch of boiler, there's 280 pound of pressure. Think about it like that. That's a lot.
It is a lot.
It's completely gone from my mind which of these three locos it is that Hornby are giving away. It's one of these three, not mine. These are mine. You can't have mine, but that's been weathered by Neville Grove. It's one of these three. What I'll do is cover that off by writing it.
I can see it on the screen right now. Is
there. Obviously, the name came about because they look like cans of spam.
Did they, though?
Well, people were obviously a lot easily pleased in those days. I mean, I guess they do look. If you compare it to a traditional steam locomotive, it's a big can.
Yeah, I can see it. Yeah, it is. Yeah, fair play.
They fascinate me. That just because they're so far removed from what you'd expect to see.
Yeah.
I mean, like you say, you got the Art Deco-ness of the A4s or the when the
Princess Coronation. I love these as well.
Yeah, the Princess Coronation, like the Duchess, when that was streamlined, very svelte. That was more American.
It was very American.
And you know, the early ones kind of had that with the Widow's Peak, I think it's called that shape. But these things, they're like Goliaths, aren't they? And you can see in the dead front, it's like...
Ugh. Hench.
Yeah. What does that mean?
Hench means the same as...
I'm running out of facts or information that may not be true. So yeah. Here we go. This is...
That number seven in the...
This was the seventh one off the line. Aberdeen Commonwealth. This, when I saw this in the Hornby catalogue, I think 3-4 years ago, it was like, yes. Because it's the early shape, so we've got the slanted...
No reflector.
The slanted cab there.
Yeah.
And just that svelte... It's not the right word, is it? But just that shape on the front, brilliant. I was like, yes, can't wait for that to come out. So it's basically the same shape as Channel Packet, Royal Mail, but it's in black. I mean, look at it, what a beast.
Mm.
That one is your standard Hornby model, and I think what a beauty.
Yeah, that's mega.
Wartime black, obviously. It probably would have come out of the shop in green and then flopped a bit of black paint on it. I'm sure someone will tell me if it's been in a different colour. Yeah. But the thing about these is, because they spent so much time developing them and modifying them, actually, truth be told, it's probably impossible to model it exactly because they changed it as they went along.
Yeah, definitely.
And here...
Is that the same one?
It was the same one. It has been renamed and numbered by, guess who?
Neville Grove.
Correct. To 21C2, so the second.
Okay.
So you see there, we've put the metal plates on the side rather than the numbers. And he's.
Can you buy these metal plates?
I think he got them from Fox Transfers. Well, might be wrong. If I'm wrong, I'll put it in. Anyway.
Nice.
But they're etched. They're not stickers. They're etched like brass sort of thing.
Yeah, yeah.
Again, I could be
nice
wrong.
Nice bit of weathering
this
on
is how
there.
Much I and again, I said to him, I want the kind of oily rag, but bit used look, and I think it just suits it. Almost, if I had a third one, it would look quite nice in just dull, wouldn't it? Because in standard, it's kind of a satiny.
Yeah.
And this is what you got your gloss, but I think it would probably look quite nice in a dull coat.
I'm sure there's always room for one more.
Well, what I want to do is do one with the modified front smoke deflector, so it's sort of a halfway house between this one. And, but that means cutting up a model, and I don't think I'm brave enough. So
is there no one that does a white metal kit?
There is, but it still means cutting up
right, okay.
A £20 model.
£20, £20.
It is £20. I mean, you've got 20 lots of £20. It gets a bit scary.
So how many of these were actually made in total? Do you know that?
30 merchant navies were built and 110 light Pacific, so 110 West countries. And so that's my...
So you're only 10 away.
Yeah, well, that's my unrebuilt merchant navy collection. So I've got 11 of those. So my aim is to collect in rebuilt and unrebuilt form all of the merchant navies.
I always think that's back to front. The unrebuilt ones are the ones that have got all the nice streamlining on it,
yeah.
And the rebuilt ones are the ones that don't have them on it.
I know what you mean.
It's a bit back to front, isn't it?
Yeah, but that's my fleet. I've got. There's a couple more new releases coming out soon, which are on pre-order. But
the other one with the boiler showing in the bang, having a little play. It's good.
But it's quite a nice collection. Yeah, that's a work in progress, that one at the back. I keep doing a bit on it every now and again. But just the weathering on them just makes so much difference. I was going to do a guide on how to weather a merchant navy, and what I was going to do was put all the stuff out, and then just smash it to one side and say, take it to Neville.
I was about to say, you're going to show Neville how to do it. Yeah.
Smash all that out of the way and just take it to Steve. That's what I do. So now we're on to the light Pacific. So Blackmoor Vale, resident of Bluebell Railway, as you know. This probably qualifies as my most expensive model now, because it's sound fitted, it's got a smoke generator in it, it's been weathered by Steve. It also fell apart the other week, so it's been away and been repaired by Roxley Models to bring it back to life. Thank you very much to those guys for helping me out with that, because it was like, what happens here then? It fell apart.
You don't do fiddly.
No, I didn't. There was a high attrition rate making this video. I broke 3 locomotives. It's not the best hobby for me. But yeah, as you can see, the weathering just makes that model, just finishes it off. I wanted it to depict like the end of a weekend, perhaps at the Bluebell, where it's been used all weekend for a car or whatever. Still got that sheen to it, but it's dirty.
Nailed that.
Yeah, smashed it. I think that was the first model I sent to Steve, and I mean, he's had many £20 off of me since then.
Well worth it, though.
Yeah, honestly, I wouldn't. Yeah.
It brings the hobby alive. Yeah. Look, there she is, chuffing away. Look. Isn't it? It does bring the model alive, doesn't it, to be fair?
I know we're away from merchant navies now, but I have got some random facts for you.
Yeah,
see, just before I start, this is one I started doing myself before, believe it or not, Steve was even on the scene.
Yeah.
And I wasn't sure about it, so I put it back in the box. But again, I wanted the...
real grimy look.
Grimy, but it's also got a sheen to it there. Nothing like what he's doing, but...
not a bad attempt, I had to go.
It's still, you know, it's one of them that I did a bit, put it in the box, did a bit, put it in the box. I was surprised that it actually worked when I put it on. The joy of having DC loop, because I need about 5 of these are DCC, the rest are DC.
And right.
Anyway, back to my merchant navy facts. Did you know, Bob, they were good for generating enormous power, even though they used really crap fuel. So they were really good from that point of view.
Do you get crap fuel? How did that even work?
Cheap coal, wasn't it? They didn't have to stick anything in there to get it.
I didn't realise you'd get good and bad coal. Didn't realise that.
You think you've got to remember this is wartime, you know.
Everyone needs coal.
His bullied boiler in here was considered to be excellent. I don't know what makes an excellent boiler, but it was considered to be excellent.
Something that boiled sufficiently.
As we've already said, excellent at high speed. That's the side that I haven't weathered. Now, they were beset with problems. Obviously, I said about the oil bath chain. This is Bude, by the way. I bought this one, you'll note, in a second, because it's got strange, longer smoke deflectors. You know, they come to the halfway across the front wheel. And I thought, well, that's different, because Blackmoor Vale's got a really short one, and this has got a really long one, and the rest are in between. So I thought, let's have one of each.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, with the oil bath splashing oil everywhere, what used to happen is it used to get up under the lagging underneath the boiler, mixed with dust and all the other stuff under there. It would catch fire.
Oh, nice.
Which is bad, obviously. So they'd have to get the fire brigade in, and the fire brigade would spray it with cold water, which would then stress it all, because you're putting cold water on a hot boiler. So that wasn't so good. They used a lot of fuel, albeit they were good on it. They used a lot of it. Driver's visibility was and still is on all the ones that remain today an issue with that cab. And these facts go across both the Merchant Navy and the Light Pacifics. Driver's visibility was terrible because the smoke was just whoosh, and these smoke deflectors were just attempts to get it away, but they even modified the cab, didn't work. Exeter was in our recent dash haul, whatever you want to call it.
Was it?
Yep.
Oh, brilliant.
which is the first of the light Pacifics, 34001. And the Wilson.
What makes these ones light then?
They're smaller.
What, in actual stature?
Yeah, yeah, they are smaller. And I didn't research that, so okay, I can't tell you. Right. Made of lighter things. But I think it's because they're
super leggera of the.
Yeah, they're physically smaller. Spamcans. I mean, you have one of these next to a merchant navy and they are smaller in length. Still massive, but small.
Yeah.
So
this isn't a merchant navy?
No, this is a light Pacific. We're on the light Pacific tower.
Ah, right,
so
okay.
Look very similar, but they're just smaller. So the reason they did the light Pacifics was they could do the lines that the merchants couldn't go on.
Right.
They needed a Pacific train or, you know, an express passenger train.
So you got your 5 series and your 3 series.
But these would also run the freight as well, so they were mixed traffic rather than just passenger.
Nice.
See, they were, all the merchant navies were all going to be scrapped and replaced by Britannia class locos in 1954. They came really close to it, Bob, as there were problems, all those problems I just listed. But luckily, they just missed getting the chop, and it was decided they'd rebuild them all. So that's when they took all of the merchant navies, took all of the air smooth casing off, stuck your standard type valve gear on the side, made it look more like what you would associate as a.
Got rid of the chain drive?
Yeah. So it had, you know, the linkage that you would expect to see on the side of a steam loco. It looked more like what you would, you know, think. It was more standardised, I guess. And that was kind of because of A, all of the problems, and B, there was an incident with one of them where it had a fractured crank axle and a brake pad flew out or something and smashed a bit of station down and nearly did a lot of damage, but luckily didn't. And they investigated it and had a cracked crank axle, and then they checked all the others because they withdrew it immediately, all of them, and they all had the same problem. So it was like, let's rebuild these.
Wow.
Let's get them rebuilt.
But A, it's lucky they weren't scrapped then, isn't it, really?
Yeah, very lucky. But they didn't rebuild all of the light Pacifics. They rebuilt a lot of them and all of them because, believe it or not, with all the skirts and that on it, it was lighter than it was when it was more of a standard engine, would you believe? It's quite a rare loco, you know, with the twiddly wheels and what have you. I bought it because I thought it looked nice.
Yeah.
That's pretty much the end of why I bought that. 222 Squadron. Obviously, I don't know if you're aware, West Country locos were named after towns in the West Country, and Battle of Britain's were named after Battle of Britain figures, squadrons. This was one of the locos that I got in that first job lot that I bought a couple of years ago. This is the only one I didn't sell, actually. Oh, this and one of the Winston Churchills. I don't know why this one in particular, but there it is, majestic.
It is.
Oh dear. And I've actually run out of facts now, so we're getting near the end of the video. And I hope you haven't been too bored.
No. At least it wasn't like a black fire or something, because I'm just not fussed on the way they look. Yeah. These are all cool. Sorry for the black fire fan. How do I know what these names are? This is you.
Yeah, you could.
I know that they've got these silly things that are really high.
Is it you don't. Black, what silly things are
Blackfire, is that not the one with the big tender?
That's a big high tender? The one with the boiler that sits.
Yeah, really high boiler.
That's a 9F.
Oh, I don't like them.
You don't like them?
I don't like the high boiler thing, no.
They're beasts. It's difficult.
They look weird, though.
I guess we're coming at it from this different angles, because you're looking at it like that looks
aesthetically.
Yeah, whereas I'm coming
amazing.
At it, what a machine. It just interests me on an engineering level as much as anything else.
What, how something so high doesn't fall over?
Just, what, it's an absolute beast of a thing, isn't it? It is, isn't it? It's like.
Right.
Anyway. Well, I appreciate them all, Bobby.
They are pretty cool, aren't they, to be fair? These are wicked.
Yeah. Yet to. We've been behind a rebuilt one, haven't we? At. Seven Valley.
Yes, we did.
Was that Tall Valley?
It was Tall Valley, yeah.
But that's basically one of these without all the bodywork.
Is it?
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
So that kind of brings it into real life for you, doesn't it? This is Winston Churchill. This model is one that the other one of my surviving from the job lot that I bought. National Railway Museum exclusive, but it's an earlier version. I have got two of this particular one.
Has that been weathered?
That's been weathered again by Steve. That sort of a half and half, sort of half shiny, half tired. Fighter Command, quite a special loco.
Is this the grey one?
This is photographic grey. Special edition locomotive, so not many made, although this one has been given a more the chassis from a more modern Hornby model, so it's like a your Escort with a modern engine in it. So it kind of, I don't know the benefits really, it was better underneath apparently. But this has been, Roxley have just done a sound conversion on this for me. We're not sure on the sound file, they might reblow it with a different one, but they got pulled out the stops to make sure it was done for Spamfest weekend. Brilliant. So again, thank you to my local model shop. Always support your local model shop,
100%.
Which we do, the guys at Roxley. And something, for some reason, Bob, whenever I go in there, I end up now buying a Terrier locomotive. It seems to be a thing.
Good enough buying just bits of green pony.
I don't buy olive bush anymore, I buy Terriers. So that's getting expensive.
Good for them.
Yeah, 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 it works out right for them. Anyway, so this is it's cool and great. I bought it because it's different in it to the rest. It's good.
Was it like that in real life?
Yeah, well, a lot of them came out in photographic grey for that reason. Photographs, and then they were repainted.
Oh, right, okay.
Malachite green, or, you know, BR green, whatever you want to call it. And this is the other Winston Churchill. This is the most recent Hornby model. I haven't actually put them together and compared the quality of it yet, which I probably should have done, really. But this, like I say, shooting this video. labour of love, Bob, a labour of love. But if you, I mean, if you've made it this far, viewers, well done.
Congratulations.
We are nearing the end now, so you can
start getting
comfy.
Maybe crack open and open a can of Spam.
Yes, Spam on toast. Spam, Spam, Spam. No, it's not stuck.
Egg and Spam.
About the egg. I think, you know, the Spam can has been in Hornby's collection for many, many years, and I think they've struggled to improve on how it, you know, the quality of the model is such a good quality model. They have got two coming out, which I've got on pre-order, which are...
Have you?
In their Dublo range, so they've brought back the die cast, so they'd be good and heavy.
Oh, really?
Rather than plastic, yeah.
Oh, wow, cool.
So, yeah, looking forward to those arriving. I think, actually, in the next couple of weeks, which is a shame we just missed out on Spamfest with it, but that's the way it is. And that is pretty much this video, Bob. It was a bit of running, but, you know, that's pretty much it. So.
It was a nice to run a few locos, especially
this. It was stressful, mate. I'm not going to lie to you. Bloody nightmare.
It's, do you remember the next time you have a good idea?
No, I'll keep quiet. It's trying to get it so, you know, it was so stressful when the bloody, sorry, speaking French, the controller stopped working. It all nearly went on fire last night when I was trying to get the last bit of footage. So not as much running stuff as I would have liked, but anyway, that's the way it is. So if you've made it this far, well done, thank you. Don't forget, if you want to win that Hornby locomotive, you need to A, share pictures of your Spam cans on Instagram or Facebook, then you need to like or subscribe to our channel and Neville Grove's channel, you need to leave a comment against our Spamfest videos, and Hornby will do the rest, so good luck with that.
Yeah, good luck, well worth winning that.
Yeah, and get sharing your pictures, because we love to see it.
Oh, 100%.
And yeah, thanks for watching, there'll be another video when I put the fire out in the shed.
You cooking Spam?
No, I'm setting fire to it. Honestly, man.
Oh dear.
Yeah. I think that's us.
Yeah.
Hope you enjoyed that.
That's good.
Thanks, guys.
Bye.